Hello, everyone. Good morning. I will roll the panel going. My name is Seo Lee. I'm an art historian and scholar of visual culture of Korea and the world through inter and intra-Asian connections. I am truly honored to be here today. I would like to thank the incredible team at the NAM Center and also echo everyone else yesterday and this morning in thanking the conference organizers. I'm especially grateful to be part of the 10th edition of the Perspectives on Korea, Contemporary Korea Conference, because as I learned yesterday, this is the first time that the conference includes panels on artists and practitioners like architects. So without further ado, what I would like to do is to introduce Eungi Min from Space Beam and Eunseom Park from Listen to the City, the first two presenters of this panel. So Space Beam, represented here today by Eungi Min, started out as a local art study group in 1995 and have performed various activities like hosting seminars, publishing art magazines, and planning exhibitions. In a need to secure space for regular meetings and activities, it opened its studio in Gwaldong, Incheon, in January 2002. Since then, Space Beam has tried to establish the unique identity of local culture as an alternative art space under the motto of publicity, locality, and autonomy. It intervenes in the course of production, circulation, and consumption of discourse on local art, and sets the stage for open meetings and productive communications while struggling with the centralized culture and art system. In September 2007, it moved to an abandoned rice wine brewing building located in Paedari in Changyeongdong, Incheon, where Incheon's modern history and culture still remain. Now Space Beam is trying to play a critical role in building a desirable urban community through sharing local issues and performing various activities under the context of locality. Eunseom Park from Listen to the City is here today. And Listen to the City is an art urbanism research activism collective started in 2009. Listen to the City consists of urban researchers, designers, filmmakers, and activists. Their works have diverse forms of tactics that could change according to the themes. They're interested in how they can listen to the people or beings neglected by society. Their goal is to transition from an unsustainable city to a sustainable one. Sustainable transition is not just about equality, environmental justice, but also about culture and gender. To this extent, feminist standpoint and feminist epistemology are critical to planning a Listen to the City's activities. Listen to the City is interested in how art and creativity can transition, can transit the unsustainable neoliberalist system to a sustainable one. The collective's main goal is to reveal the contradictions in the city and create the field of discussion through empowering people without a voice. So without further ado, I would like to welcome Eungi Min, who will speak in Korean, and we will have a simultaneous interpretation available in the English channel.
네, 방금 소개받은 민운기라고 합니다.
I'm Eungi Min. Good morning, everyone. I'm thank you for the invitation, and I'm delighted to meet everyone in this session virtually. As I was introduced, I have been involved with Space Beam, an art organization, an alternative space, for the past 20 years. This morning, I'll share with you our activities and protests against the local government's urban development agenda as briefly as I can in the limited time I have. So I'll start with a few words about the neighborhood, about Space Beam, and then the expressway issue, our first fight. So Space Beam is located in Incheon, a metropolitan city of 3 million population, adjacent to Seoul and facing the West Sea.
인천시 안에서도
구도심 is located in a neighborhood called Paedari in the old town section of the city that is still expanding today. The old town section, which include both the foreign concessions and the Korean settlement, was the heart of the city's cultural
역사 문화의
and economic life from the late 1800s when Joseon began opening its ports until about the late 1980s. But in the recent decades, old town neighborhoods have been declining as the city expanded and old urban centers moved to new locations. Space Beam started out in 1995 as an art group, as introduced earlier. Then in 2002, it opened a space in Gwaldong, which was then the new downtown area. In 2007, it moved to the current location in Paedari. So this sums up what we are in a nutshell. So this is basically our value. We want to activate a proactive and autonomous culture. We want to empty out capitalist desires from me and empty out the ruling power apparatuses from our living spaces. We came to Paedari quite accidentally while we were engaged in a public art project called Urban Nomad, subtitled Discovery. We came to Paedari and set up our tent where there was a vacant land, a vacant lot. It turned out that houses were recently demolished here and the ground dug up, as we see here. The neighborhood was bisected by the large patch of the land dug up here. It was really terrible sight to behold. We looked into the matter. It turned out that Incheon City was pursuing a so-called global branding project and lobbying for foreign investment. In this photo, the circle on the top is Cheongna and the circle on the bottom is Songdo. If they are two Incheon, they are two of the three Incheon free economic zones. If you draw a straight line from Cheongna to Songdo, Paedari is in the middle. So that is why and how they wanted to construct an expressway to connect the two IFAS districts. So the earlier was the old picture, and now you see the neighborhood bisected so that the two sections of the Incheon city could be connected as fast as possible. We decided that the expressway must be stopped because it was destroying a neighborhood steeped in history. Nearby, we found this brick building, an old Makgeolli brewery, now in disuse. We rented this place and moved in. This is what the inside looked like. But the space had many charming points, including the unique structure. We renovated the space, preserving the old traces as much as possible. We had an opening ceremony after the renovation. It was a reopening of Space Beam at the new space. This is, I should say, a metal robot, a guardian. It has become mascot for Space Beam and a guardian angel for the neighborhood. Then the long fight to stop the expressway started. We held rallies in the neighborhood, at the construction sites, and in front of the city hall. In the meantime, we learned that the city planned to raise to the ground not only 배다리, but the entire area surrounding the neighborhood to develop shopping malls and high-rise apartment buildings. So it was a much larger redevelopment plan than we had ever expected. It was nothing compared to the expressway. They wanted to build a new town and erase the old town altogether. And this is the picture. We realized that stopping the expressway would be in vain if we could not stop this, because this was a destruction of the old city at a much larger scale, as I've said. We worked closely with the residents to stop the city from going ahead with this. We successfully stopped the so-called public hearing from taking place, which was a big blow to the city because the city was about to go ahead with the project no matter what happened at the meeting, as long as it took place. So we stopped it. Then we proposed an alternative to the city's plan, an alternative to a large-scale, capital-driven urban redevelopment plan. Our alternative was a model based on the concept of Echo Museum, which was both conceptual and practical model for us. We carried out various programs and activities based on this model, the Echo Park model. In terms of space, what Echo Museum advocates in urban regeneration is the recovery and representation of local characters in a neighborhood. In terms of community life, it advocates living a life of solidarity. In terms of economics, it advocates a virtual cycle of social, cultural, and ecological production and consumption. Finally, in terms of ecology, it advocates building a sustainable eco village. This is roughly the picture of an eco village we have in mind. To practice what we proposed, we started an art factory and opened an art space, the brewery that is, to local residents. So we added art to a brewery here. The participants became the creative agents of art and changes in neighborhood and in their own lives rather than remaining the spectator. We also invited artists from Korea and abroad to mutually broaden local artistic practices and interpretation in urban issues. Old motels and other facilities now in disuse were turned into cultural spaces for exchange and communication. They were used as community spaces as well as for open artist residency programs. So here it says come hell or high water. They were trying to encourage us here. We also set up LETS for local exchange and trade system and issued local currency. Echo Museum advocated building a network of relationships that did not depend on money. So here's a 배다리 money ceremony. This is a launching of the 배다리 money. what we held regular community events where 배달이 money could be used. 네, here I made I'm making drawing persimmons. It look doesn't it look like an art project? This is a do-it-yourself carpentry shop within the brewery. This is an exhibition of 배달이 Recycle Reuse Residency Workshop. Now we took a workshop from inside the brewery to the streets. This is a diagram for 배달이 Recycling Program. This is Space Beam became the center for recycling, and the neighborhood became a space for recycling. Here, we installed a rainwater storage tank by the community garden. We ran a carpentry on demand program for public work in the neighborhood. We installed a bench or a deck in the neighborhood. So we formed a team and made what the neighborhood needed. What's a community without a parade? More pictures of the parade. And here I suggested this contest of drinking makgeolli. The fastest drinker is the winner in this contest. So this is the finalist. They were the finalist, and more drinking even after the contest. We also invited an indie band. It was the finale of the parade. So in addition to these activities, we ran various other programs in close cooperation with local residents. In the meantime, we turned the vacant lot, slated to build the expressway into a park. We wanted it to be the center of this community, and it was blocked up so that nobody could enter. So we thought about what we could do. This is what the place looked like. So we would sneak in and cleaned up an enormous amount of garbage and debris, and we envisioned a different kind of a development for the ground here. We had fun. So we sneaked in when we had to, because the place was blocked up, and began building a park. And this park was then had a surprise opening during the parade. So we opened up when the city had boarded up. So we gave it a name, 배달이 Eco Park. Surely it was no Jurassic Park, but for us, it became incomparable in value. Children love to rock climb here, such as it is. It became a true public space for all to enjoy. People naturally understood that having this was better than having an 8-lane expressway cutting through the neighborhood. Scarecrows appeared in the fall. We made them, and every year, this is a lunar year celebration at full moon. This is a traditional ceremony of building a bonfire at the first full moon of the lunar new year. We also made sure that we had a community garden at the corner of the park. We also built a gazebo by the garden. So you can see here the garden or the gazebo by the garden. Every summer, we held 배달이 Echo Camp. We called it Garden Vacation. Or Bat Hangs. Only vegetarian meals were served during the camp. And at night, we watched films together. Later on, we built a playground for children to play for adventure and for play. Children started coming by. So they would go around the entire park using what we had installed there. So the quiet neighborhood, what was usually quiet, now became filled with excited and high-pitched voices of the children playing around. So this is a view of the park. So this is my drawing of the park. So this picture shows 배달이 we envisioned as an eco museum. However, when tourists started flocking to the neighborhood after a popular TV drama was filmed in the neighborhood, and the movies were filmed here, the local coup office began making various capital-driven gentrification plans. They planned to have facelift jobs for neighborhood landmark buildings. They installed large sculpture. They named the streets. They installed this so-called green plaza and neon lights. More recently, another blow came to us. They selected 30 entrepreneurs to open businesses, and the coup office subsidized them. It's true that the streets became less gray, but this is far from what we had envisioned under Echo Museum, the idea of Echo Museum. This store illustrates why it was a bad idea here. Koreans rent a school uniform and put on a school uniform and have a tour of the neighborhood in a electric vehicle. In another blow to us, the coup office also wanted a manicured garden instead of Echo Park, so they told the residents not to have a garden anymore, and in a surprise raid, the slide and the playground was demolished, and they were taken away to an unknown place. It was in quite a surprise raid. So we demanded to return the playground back to us. But after much conflict, the coup office took the park away from us. So this is what happened to the Echo Park. They wanted a manicured garden of a sort. They wanted to turn nature into a spectacle, something only to watch. We did fight back and negotiated with them. So the park was split into two, where one section was maintained by the coup office and another side was maintained by us. So it was quite a joke. So in the meantime, we protested again to completely get rid of the expressway plan, and we went on a sit-in protest in a tent for over 500 days, and we did come to an agreement. According to the office, was supposed to come up with the plan with us, but in a violation of the agreement, the coup office made plans without consulting us. So we organized again and demanded the coup office to abide by the agreement. After much twists and turns, a working plan came out. However, the residents were not consulted, but simply notified through a public presentation session. So this is about how to use the empty ground. They even secured the budget. So something strange now started happening. Groups that previously did not show any interest in our fight began claiming credit for what had happened. Another unwelcome development in the neighborhood is that high-rise apartments buildings are rapidly surrounding 배다리. We wanted to expand Echo Museum concept with 배다리 as a model case. Instead, we are now being surrounded by exactly the opposite kind of urban regeneration. What we pursued was an open city Incheon community. We worked hard and exchanged actively with various other agents of change locally and internationally. Thus, the recent developments have not been encouraging. This year, too, we carried out various programs for sustainable future, seeking alternative to capital-driven urban regeneration. However, the prospects for achieving our vision seem more uncertain than ever. This is a review of what we have been striving for so far in our fights and activities. Beyond fighting, what we are striving, these are what we are striving for. We wanted to provide resistance and criticism. We wanted to respect history, culture, ecology, and community and their values as a commons and strive to incorporate them as the dominant principle of life. We wanted to restore the rights of local residents because they are the actual owners of the city, not merely the subject of bureaucratic administration. Our uphill struggle will continue against the capital-driven plans that privilege private monopolization of urban commons. Here's our picture of the Incheon as an eco museum. Come what may, we plan to continue our eco museum tour, paying our respects to local history, culture, and community. That is all for my presentation. Thank you for your attention.
So today I'm going to talk about feminist insurgent planning for sustainable transition. So I did a PhD in urban planning. Actually, my bachelor is fine art. And especially painting. I did my MA in painting and I did my MA and PhD in urban planning again. So Listen to the City is an art urbanism research collective, which started in 2009. So already explained this a little bit, so I will just make it shorter. And my team is quite flexible, and Hyunwook and Chungun still working with me. And my team is very flexible, so if you like to join, you can join. So this is our research question. What are the commons and who owns them? What does Listen to the City do for sustainable transition? Who are the people with our voices? Where is the periphery of the city? How does it connect to feminist insurgent planning? So what are the commons? Who owns them? The concept of commons is very important for Listen to the City activities, because it seems like we do so many diverse things, but actually it all connected through commons. The commons means the cultural natural resources accessible to everyone in the society. The commons include natural substances such as water, forest, seas, mountains, air, sky, and the earth. These resources should belong to the community. The communities should manage these assets for collective benefits, not for the private benefits. Listen to the City sees cities as a part of commons because collective memories and knowledge have made the cities. Thus, we tried to stop privatization of the city spaces, nature, and cultural assets. So what listen to the city do for sustainable transition? We tried to listen to the people excluded from the community and try to see the society through their perspective. To listening from marginalized people, we need feminist epistemology and feminist standpoint. Therefore, against the mainstream neoliberal planning, we need the feminist inclusion planning. Our activities close to distribution of sensible referred by Jacques Langshier rather than traditional art. So what is feminist inclusion planning? Actually, I wrote a paper about it in Korean. Probably later I will write in English again. So based on feminist epistemology and feminist standpoint against imperialism and patriarchy, feminist insurgent planning against anti-historicism, feminist insurgent planning emphasizes the inclusiveness and diversity of the city. Based on rights to the city and trust in imaginations, feminist insurgent planning questioning about governance and participation used as a Trojan horse by neoliberal urban developers and governors. Some of them will question about this when we can talk about it later. So this is the diagram, very famous diagram of dynamic multi-level perspective on transition. So we need like networks, cultural symbolic meaning, infrastructure, technology and markets and sectoral policy, techno science, technology. So whole thing need to work together for a transition. So probably there are so many failed innovation, but anyway, the whole part of society need to collaborate for make a sustainable transition. That's why we are so listen to the city connects to so many different parts in the society. So I'm going to show you today just seven activities. So firstly, we started with making alternative urban planning magazine, which started in 2009. The year had the Leongsan massacre. It affected us really a lot. So actually, six people get killed during the eviction in 2009. So it was a part of Daniel Levitsky's new, you know, like mega project. It called Archipelago. Yeah, so someone, I heard that yesterday there was some debate on responsibility of the architect. I think I cannot blame Daniel Levitsky, but at least he should think about the responsibility about his practice. So this is one of the map that we made. This is from 2015, and there are so many redevelopment projects going on in Seoul, only Seoul. Yeah, so that's why we are interested in redevelopment and replacement, because that happens really a lot in South Korea. Yeah, and one of our ongoing project is Seoul Tours. So there are several courses that showing you the controversy scenery of Seoul. So it's which is Hwanghak-dong, Inhwang Mountain, Dongdaemun area, and Cheonggyecheon and Four River. So this is the map of the tour. And so we wanted to Lotte Castle Venezia because it's near the Cheonggyecheon River. They call it Venezia. Anyway, they evicted the street vendors and they built Venezia there. And this is a mount at the entrance of the Inhwang Mountain. Inhwang Mountain is very important mountain in Seoul history. And you cannot really see them because the apartment, but which is very common and people don't have any problem. You know, Seoul people don't really care about it. And this is one of our interesting performance called Klaus Oldenburg's Spring. And then the architect never been to Korea, and then he built this weird sculpture, and Korean government paid a lot. So research, actually from this tour, our research actually began because I need to explain about the Cheonggyecheon and, you know, the process of gentrification. So Cheonggyecheon is so popular in urban planning era, especially in Harvard GSD. Everyone praises Cheonggyecheon really a lot, but it's quite funny because they don't know the history, and actually not many scholars really write properly about the history. And so the purpose of the project was historical restoration and ecological restoration, economical renaissance. But there are problems: destroy of urban history and culture, lost identity of the city and the collective memories and the light to the city. So this is a process of Cheonggyecheon renovation. So it seems nice, you know, like they got rid of the highway, and they cleaned up and they restored the river. Looks like no problem, but and then became a quite popular place. But actually, it's not really ecological because this is the original river basin. They had just 2 years for renovation. So they actually didn't do proper job. That's typical Korea. So they put some rubber coat on the original river basin, and then they put some concrete and pebbles and stones, and then they put some tap water. That's not natural water. This is tap water. So the other purpose of Cheonggyecheon project was historical restoration. This is Gwanggyo. And when they unearthed, actually they found so many embankment stones and footstones of bridges, and they embraced because they didn't expect it. So you know what? Actually, they threw them away. They didn't restore that properly. This is still abandoned in some area in South Korea. I mean, in Seoul. So actually, and a lot of vendors and street vendors evicted for the project. So can we really call it an economical renaissance? You know, some people lost their work and job since then. And, you know, street vendors are not resilient at all, you know? So, and the market, street market, informal market was really big, huge, but they are forcibly evicted in 7 months without any compensation or any, you know, alternate plan. And they brutally evicted by police, and actually they broke out the pavement to prevent street vendors coming back. That was really brutal. And this history of destroying the city fabric is getting repeated and repeated and never ends. So after Lee Myung-bak, Oh Se-un became a mayor, and in 2009 Pimako was demolished, and Oh Se-un demolished the city hall without permission of the government. It was really bizarre and feels really wrong. And the other project we did is a disaster prevention project, which is linked to ecological restoration. So if you walk around Cheonggyecheon, it seems nice. There is nothing really wrong. But actually, when it rains a lot, sewer gate opens. But not many Seoul people know about this. So they sometimes, if rains a lot, the sewer gate opens. And automatically, so people are isolated there, so which is quite dangerous. So nowadays we have sirens and a better announcement, but back in 5 years, because 5-10 years, Oh Se-un was a mayor, so he wants to cover up this problem, so they didn't do any like announcement. So listen to the city and the workshop participant, we measure the science of sewer gates and location, and we did a open street map together, and we made a disaster prevention map together. So if you go to open street map, you can see the location of the surrogate. So the other one is a gentrification map of Cheonggyecheon and Dongdaemun area. So the red dot is meaning the location of street vendors. Actually, this is very brief and abstract because no one really knows how many street vendors were there actually. So we made this map through interviews and workshops. So he's one of the evictees. He was a former street vendor. And we realized that actually from this map, we cannot really explain much. So we wanted to listen from what we wanted to record their stories and why he became a street vendor. We wanted to show the story of him. And so he shared his story and we made a kind of memory map. And then we did it together with another man called Mingi, and he's an activist about urban poverty. And then Jongsuk, she's used to be a street vendor at Dongdaemun area. And so it's naturally linked to Dongdaemun project. I heard that somebody liked the Dongdaemun project. I know you can like it, but actually you should know the background, and then you can decide whether you like it or not, you know. So I used to work around here, so I know the place very well. And actually the evictees from Cheonggyecheon, they relocated here because it used to as like parking lot, and there are some spaces. So street vendors, they raised the fund and they covered up for a market. And then the right one is a baseball stadium that it was the only one baseball stadium for amateurs. And the city government, the Oseo mayor, that he wants design. So why design? Why do we need a design? But he announced this design soul project, and they decided to evict them for a new project called Dongdaemun Design Plaza, which is designed by Sahagi. She won the first prize. So there was a very interesting market and street vendors, and then they get evicted again. So like it was brutal again. So it's like one of the street vendors said, "We are not stones. We cannot kick out." You know, like so. And then after evict everyone, they found another large scale of remains. You know what? They just took, threw them away again. This is bad reputation. It's really annoying. They just got rid of everything. And now they built this huge building. It looks nice, but they spent too much for maintaining because they designed the building, but they never considered the contents. So there's no contents actually. So they lent out for stupid shows and things like that. They don't have any identity. That's the problem. And for this building, actually they wanted to change the pavement here too. So they wanted to evict another street vendors to change this pavement. So in a Seoul city, for Seoul city is, you know, like pavement is prior than people. Yeah. And actually eviction is still going on and on, never finishes. So we did one of a very interesting project called Do Better Design Than Zaha Did. We did, we did a small squatting and we did, the guerrilla design competition there. And this is the book about it. You can have a look later. Okay. And there is another eviction now at the moment. This part is the whole area going to be demolished. This is called Ilchiro and Cheonggyecheon. So this is really huge project. You know, our studio is here, but I even didn't know that they are demolishing the buildings. So no one knew that, no one knew the exact fact about this project. So I made Cheonggyecheon Ilchiro Anti-Gentrification Alliance 2018 with many scholars and designers and activists. So please visit cheonggyecheon.com. Yeah. research on industrial, we research on industrial ecosystem and reclaim on alternative working space, changing the gentrification ordinances. We changed a lot actually, and we do so many you know, research on the place. And they wanted to build this kind of, you know, residential building here, and actually everywhere in El Chiro. So the LA is beautiful, people are beautiful, and you can read the articles later. And we really like the people here. They've been working here over 30 years, and then they're skilled people. And if Cheonggyecheon demolished, the life of them is also getting demolished. So one of our project was post-urbanizing. So we asked designers to join us, and over 200 designers submitted their poster against to the gentrification. So we hold the poster and we rallied together. It was good fun. We cannot do it because of COVID. And the other one is we actually research about ecological industrial ecological system, and then we made a website about that with Wonyoung Seoul. So you can visit the website here later. And I'm going to have another talk about it like two days later at the How About the GSD. So if you're interested, please join. And then one of the routine of Cheonggyecheon Eujuro Anti-Gentrification Alliance is like meeting with merchants and workers. We do like regularly at least twice in a week, really a lot. And then we research and archiving. And nowadays we do Tumblebug crowdfunding. So please put your money there if you want to support us. And actually this is Eujuro Obi Bear, and they are going to be evicted too. So we did concert here recently. This is part of the Voice of LA. And this is the Mansan Hopu, the pub. Another pub is kind of really big pub, and they wanted to evict everyone around Eujuro. So this is me like beautifully squatting on the car. And actually, so they keep trying to evict them. So we wanted to protect the shop. So we do many cultural events. 2 weeks ago, we had a really nice concert. Please visit our YouTube. You can watch them. And an artist, famous artist, even helped us really. And we run tours. So please join. You can join from next week. And we did a virtual concert as well. So you can see Gong Joong-gun's concert on the street. If you visit here, you can watch it through your phone. And we do like. The merchant workers made their own poems and they read it. And this is my drawings that we made, like calendars for giveaway. If you donate money, you can get it. Yeah. So Naesang River is in the middle of the country and used to be really beautiful. Sorry about this. And actually it used to be like this, and then they start to make them, and now it's even worse. And I really like this place. It's so beautiful, and Seoul also visited here. Now you cannot really recognize the place. I feel really down and I'm really gloomy because I lost the place completely changed. I became really gloomy because of this. You cannot really recognize this place. So many trees cut down, and this is one of my picture from there. It's now it became like this. It's really crazy. So this is happening. So there's no hope in this world. I think no hope. Yeah. And look at this water. I cannot believe it. So this is our gallery, small gallery. We can move around when we. This small gallery was in Jogesa, and this is Hongdae Driban. We move this container to solid for join Driban movement. So naturally, I joined Driban movement. So we did so many exhibitions about Four River Project, and we researched about river, and we purchased river basin with the citizens and built a museum about the river. And I researched about the you know, willow trees and tree, the birds. This is my drawing. And I made a book about it, sold out. You cannot buy it anymore. Even I don't have one. This is endangered animals. So I had many exhibitions about it. Yeah. And I have no more time. I will just talk about Duriban just two minutes. So Duriban is one of the very important place for art activism, I think. So which had so many art project here. So, and we did Duriban Film Festival since 2011. And there are so many gigs happened there and so many musicians joined the activism and they won. And then after that, actually Cafe Mari is a little, we failed actually. There are so many, we got it after Duriban, but the Yongyeokgangpae, the gangsters, they came so often. It was so brutal. It wasn't like a Duriban. Actually in Duriban, that there are not, actually no gangsters invaded there, but in here, like every day, the like, you know, twice in a week, so many, you know, like gangsters visited and it was so brutal. It was really crazy. This is a good example of contemporary art. So we, you know, we did a real crazy fight, and then the merchant here, they secretly made an agreement without knowing us, you know, without notice to the activists. It was really crazy. So it's happening all the time, you know, like the betrayment is happening. So and then this is Banaji Alley, and same thing happened in beautiful alley. And this is Pagwansa, the area Pagwansa lives. And we read a poem of her and part of her novel. And actually Bruce Fulton helped us to do this performance. But anyway, this alley also demolished. So it's really gloomy, yeah. So there was another brutal eviction. This is my team, Hyunwook. And it was brutal as well. Yeah. Okay, I'll finish my presentation now. Thank you.
We'll start with a recorded video gathering of Rice Brewing Sisters Club and their friends. So Rice Brewing Sisters Club is a collective of sisters, Soyeon Ryu, Hyunjin Shin, Haemin Son, who work with social fermentation as an artistic form. The collective sees fermentation as not only a biochemical transformation, but also an open-ended process that traverses visual art, performance, cooking, creative writing, oral history, ecological thinking, and anti-wisdoms. By bringing in the elements of social in various forms, the collective experiments with ways to connect the sensorial with the relational. While operating on a yearly membership, the collective aims to collaborate beyond the boundaries of a collective. This is done by hosting open-ended platforms where rice eaters from many different regions, dwellers of the past, present, and future, and other various human and non-human beings can meet and create synergetic networks. So in this gathering that you will see as a video form, Rice Brewing Sisters Club and their friends, Changguk Park, Cheoru Kim, and Somi Shim, will have a conversation. It's an open platform, and their story about moving soil, hence the title of the video. And we'll come back for the discussion.
안녕하세요. 저희는 Rice Brewing Sisters Club 손혜민이고요. 또 유소윤 어디 계세요?
여기 있습니다. 안녕하세요.
신현진.
예수님.
신현진님. 네, 이렇게 세 명이서 예술 콜렉티브로 활동을 하고 있고요. 저희는 비인간, 인간 그리고 공동체들 간의 여러 협업에 기반한 어떤 예술적인 실천을 사회적 발효라는 개념으로 이제 확장을 해서 여러 가지 포맷으로 작업을 하고 있어요. 그래서 퍼포먼스라든가 글쓰기라든가 그다음에 구술사 아카이브 혹은 이벤트를 열거나 이런 여러 가지 매체와 방법 등을 통해서 이런 그 사회적 발효라는 개념을 실천해 나가는 활동을 하고 있고요. 저희는 2018년부터 활동을 해왔고 그다음에 1년간의 멤버십을 기반으로 활동하고 있습니다. 그래서 1년 동안 활동을 하고 그 이후에 연장할 수 있거나 혹은 탈퇴를 하거나 네, 자유롭게 멤버십을 구사할 수 있는 콜렉티브 활동을 하고 있고 그리고 그러나 2019년 이후로 이렇게 저와 손혜민, 신현진, 유소연 이렇게 세 명이서 이제 같이 작업을 3년간 해온 네, 콜렉티브이며 저희가 그동안 해왔던 작업들 중에 2020년에 경기도 안성에서 크크그랜드라는 프로젝트를 진행을 했었고요. 그리고 강원도 공평 콧등 작은 미술관이라는 곳에서 첩첩담담이라는 전시를 기획해서 또 진행을 했었고 최근 광주에서는 냉장고 환상이라는 전시에 참여한 바가 있습니다. 그래서 다양한 활동을 지금 하고 있습니다. 오늘 저희가 해볼 그 워크숍은 차차 소개를 해드리려고 하는데 먼저 이 워크숍에 참여해 주신 세 분을 모셨는데 세 분에 대한 소개를 신현진 님께서 해주시겠습니다.
저희가 네, 저희가 이제 이번 이동하는 흑 워크숍은 저희가 이제 2020년도에 했던 흑흑랜드라는 프로젝트 일환으로 이제 연장선에서 기획을 했는데요. 라이스 브루잉이 3년간 이제 활동을 하면서 만나 뵙게 되었던 이제 흙과 땅에 관련해서 활동을 해오신 분들과 이번에 함께 하게 돼서 너무 좋고요. 그리고 이제 박창국 선생님께서는 이제 저희 흑흑랜드 프로젝트에 직접 참여를 해주셨었고 심소미 큐레이터님께서는 이제 환상 벨트라는 전시에서 이제 경기도 네 개 도시 기반의 리서치 프로젝트를 전시하셨을 때 저희를 초대하신 바 해주셨었고 그리고 김철우 대표님과는 저희가 몇 년간 대화만 이제 이어가다가 이번 기회로 이렇게 같이 함께 자리를 하게 돼서 너무 좋습니다. 네, 그래서 저희가 첫 세션으로는 그래도 서로의 소개를 하는 게 좋을 것 같아서 선생님들께서 이제 한 분씩 간단한 소개를 부탁드리겠습니다. 먼저 심소미 큐레이터님 부탁드릴게요.
안녕하세요. 네, 먼저 앞서서 간단하게 소개해 주셔서 많이 더할 내용은 없는 것 같은데요. 네, 저는 전시 기획을 주로 해오고 있고 관심사는 예술과 도시 그리고 이제 건축이 교차되는 지점에서 발생하는 것들에 관심을 두고 기획을 해오고 있어요. 그러다 보니까 아무래도 전시 기획이라는 물질적인 형태도 있겠지만 기획에서 파생되는 담론들을 좀 지속해 나가는 것에 관심이 많고요. 그리고 앞서서 이제 말씀 주셨던 2019년도에 공공하는 예술이라는 경기도 순회 공공미술 프로젝트를 했었고 당시 라이스 브루잉 시스터즈 클럽이 참여를 해주셨었는데요. 그 프로젝트는 이제 오늘 선생님들하고 얘기 나누면서 저도 많이 제가 풀지 못한 고민들에 대한 다양한 아마 다른 가능성을 볼 수 있는 얘기를 드릴 수 있을 것 같아요. 그 프로젝트가 저한테는 실천과 리서치 사이에서 하나의 일종의 스파크, 그 스파크가 긍정적인 것인지 혹은 조금 부정적인 것인지는 여전히 또 탐색을 하고 있는 중인데 실천과 리서치 사이에서의 접점을 만들기 굉장히 어렵구나라는 걸 많이 느꼈던 프로젝트고 그 이후로는 조금 더 리서치 쪽에 방점을 두고 해오고 있고 최근에는 리트레이싱 듀로라는 도시 리서치 측 컬렉티브를 작가 주이안 고아네와 같이 결성을 해서 이전에 지속 이전에 네 주제들을 계속 지속해 오고 있습니다. 네, 반갑습니다. 네.
반갑습니다.
반갑습니다.
다음은 김철우 대표님께서 해주시면 네. 감사하겠습니다.
반갑습니다. 저는 RTVP Alliance라는 회사를 운영하고 있고요. RTVP Alliance는 부산 영도에서 이제 영도라고 하는 곳을 기반으로 다양한 활동을 하고 있습니다. 뭐 처음 시작은 돌아오의 부산항해라고 하는 프로젝트를 가지고 세태도가 굉장히 높은 영도라고 하는 조선 항만 산업의 기반이었던 지역이 세태에 가면서 생긴 여러 가지 문제들을 어떻게 해결하거나 아니면 좀 더 나은 방법으로 대안을 제시할 수 있을까를 이제 실험해가는 과정에서 떠났던 사람들 또는 다른 사람들이 영도에 다시 돌아왔으면 좋겠다라고 하는 그런 생각을 가지고 만들어 가던 프로젝트였고요. 이제 그러다 보니 기본적으로는 장소성이라는 측면에서 공간들을 중심으로 유휴 공간들의 어떤 컨텐츠나 어떤 사람들과 무엇을 할 것인가에 대한 고민들을 계속 해왔고요. 특히 이제 도시에 관련돼 있는 일이다 보니 도시에서 중요한 요소 중에 몇 가지 중에 하나인 뭐 인력과 주거라고 하는 키워드를 가지고 인력과 주거라고 하는 것이 우리 도시 안에서 어떻게 의미를 가지고 어떻게 다른 방법으로 대안을 제시할 수 있을까에 대한 걸 계속 고민해 나가고 실험들을 해왔던 것 같습니다. 이제 그렇게 돌아와 부산항해 프로젝트를 진행했었고요. 최근에는 이제 그런 어쨌든 저희가 상업적으로 어떤 비즈니스를 하기 전 단계로 계속해서 실험하고 거기서 유의미한 것들을 빼서 사업 그리고 뭐 비즈니스나 사업 그 다음에 일종의 활동 두 가지를 이 접점을 섞으려고 하는 걸 하다 보니 저희는 그런 움직임을 만들고 나면 그걸 가지고 바로 사업을 하는 게 아니라 또 다른 대안들을 다시 한번 또 짚어 놓고 그다음에 다시 돌아가는 그런 방식으로 일을 하려고 하고요. 그래서 지금 하고 있는 건 이제 영도에 사람들의 관심은 좀 많아졌다라고 이제 저희가 판단을 해서 그러면 이제 도시가 좀 더 활성화되는 거에 대한 건 뭐 저희 힘만의 힘으로 되는 건 아니어서 이제 그렇게 트리거를 만들었다고 생각을 한 다음에 저희가 하고 있는 건 영도 물산 장려 운동이라고 해서 그러면 영도라고 하는 곳이 여기 지역에 국한되는 것이 아니라 얼마나 보편성 즉 뭐 다른 지역 또는 보편성과 연계될 수 있는지에 대한 또 가능성을 좀 만들어가는 연계고리를 만들어가는 그런 일을 하기 위한 영도물산 장려회관이라는 프로젝트를 진행하고 있습니다. 네, 여기까지 하면 될까요? 네, 반갑습니다.
네, 감사합니다. 네, 마지막으로 박창국 작가님 소개해 주시면 감사하겠습니다.
예, 저는 뭐 쿡이라고 부르고요. 예, 좀 오랫동안 뭐 외부에서 작업도 하고 그리고 기획도 하고 뭐 그런 활동을 하고 있습니다. 2011년에 제가 했던 그 뭐 논아트바다트에서 이렇게 뭐 프로젝트 1년 동안 관하고 했던 건 지속했었고 거기서 좀 싸워가지고 뭐 쫓겨났나 뭐 나왔나 모르겠는데 아무튼 그런 상황이 돼가지고 한 2년 더 있었어요. 거기 그냥 관하고는 관계없이 뭐 그 빈 창고 같은 거에 좀 있으면서 이런저런 또 뭐 사건들이 좀 있었고 그 다음에는 뭐 문화비치퀴즈라든가 서울혁신파크라든가 이런 땅에다가 뭔가를 만들거나 뭐 또 프로젝트 하거나 뭐 이런 일을 좀 했었고요. 다들 제대로 뭔가 이렇게 협력이 끝까지 잘 안 되고 대부분 쫓겨난 것 같아요. 예, 왜냐하면 뭐 우리 저 스스로 뭐 거기에서 안착을 하겠다 뭐 이런 건 아닌데 사람들이 계속해서 뭔가 이렇게 막 그 씩씩하게 오랫동안 뭔가 하려고 하면은 관이 되게 싫어하는 것 같더라고요. 예. 그래서 결과적으로는 처음에는 굉장히 흥미로운 척하면서 이렇게 잘 협력을 하는 것처럼 보였지만 결과적으로는 뭐 이렇게 담당자가 바뀌거나 뭐 시장이 바뀌거나 뭔가 되면 이게 굉장히 갑자기 개털이 되는 뭐 이런 상황이 계속됐었고요. 그래서 2013년 겨울에 이제 그 동대문에 옥상 하나를 발견해서 2014년부터 지금 한 8년째 되나요? 계속해서 뭐 이런저런 활동도 하고 놀기도 하고 거기 스튜디오도 되고 뭐 이런 식으로 이제 이어져 왔습니다. 그리고 최근에는 뭐 우연히 뭐 어쩌다가 수원에 또 약간의 그 공공실 프로젝트라고 하는 거를 맡아서 하고 있는데 이거는 정말 몇 개월 만에 지금 만든 거라서 이후의 과정은 아직은 정확히 잘 모르겠고요. 뭐 뭔가 있다면은 좀 재미나게 해볼 수도 있지 않을까라고 생각이 됩니다. 올해는 뭐 리서치 정도의 프로젝트에 가깝다고 생각이 되고요. 그리고 이제 개인적으로는 제가 어반 잼 뭐 이렇게 해가지고 뭐 여기저기 비어있는 땅, 비어있는 장소를 뭐 친구들하고 리서치도 같이 하고 거기 가서 뭐 일시적으로 좀 놀다 오고 그러면서 이제 뭐 거기에 지역에 있는 사람들이나 뭐 행정이나 이런 데랑 그거를 어떻게 다른 방식으로 좀 뭔가 얘기해 볼 수 있나 이런 것들을 가지고 뭐 비교적 별거 안 하는 것 같지만 끈질기게 예, 하고 있습니다. 뭐 한 장소에 3년, 4년 계속 집적거리는 방식으로 예.
와 소개를 했을 뿐인데 벌써 이야기할 거리들이 넘쳐나는 것 같아요. 특히 영토 해킹에 대한 이야기나 네, 룬아트 바다트의 더 구조적인 이야기는 대화를 이끌어 나가면서 좀 더 듣고 싶은 생각이네요. 네, 감사드리고 본격적으로 시작을 해보기 전에 먼저 여기 참여해 주신 선생님분들과 이걸 보고 계신 분들을 위해서 이동하는 흙, Moving Soil이라는 이 라운드 테이블에 대한 소개를 아주 살짝 드려보고자 합니다. 이 라운드 테이블은 약 40분 동안 두 단계로 나눠서 진행이 되는데요. 이 각 참여자분들께서 영토에 들어갈 흙을 가져와 주셨어요. 네, 이게 물질적인 흙이라기보다는 지금까지 작업하신 내용 중에서 영토, 흙, 공동체, 그리고 지역성, 특히 유연한 지역성의 맥락에서 생각나는 프로젝트들을 몇 가지 가져와 주셔서 그것을 저희는 흙이라고 생각을 하고 각자의 흙과 영토를 소개해보는 시간을 먼저 가질 거고 그리고 두 번째 단계에는 이 각자의 영토를 공동의 영토로 묶어보는 시간을 가지게 될 거예요. 그래서 미로보드라는 웹베이스 플랫폼을 사용해서 각자의 공동 영토로 만들어보고 그리고 그 안에서 생겨나는 여러 에너지나 여러 생물들 그리고 관계들을 드로잉 액티비티로 한번 해보려고 합니다. 그리고 나서 대화를 만들어 나갈 텐데 이동하는 흙이라는 말이 되게 넓고 은유적인 말인 만큼 되게 다양한 넓은 주제의 이야기들을 할 수 있을 것 같아요. 그래서 흙이 땅이 되는 과정을 개인이 공동체가 되는 과정 그리고 흙이 가지고 있는 고유한 성질 그리고 그에 묶여있는 장소성을 장소 특정성으로 생각해보고 그리고 또 흙의 이동, 흙이 자연환경에 따라서 혹은 인위적인 요인에 의해서 이동하는 모습을 지역성 혹은 장소 특정성이 이동하는 모습으로 상상을 해보고 그래서 유연한 지역성의 맥락에서도 생각해보려고 합니다. 네, 그게 저희의 야심찬 라운드 테이블 계획이고 어떻게 되는지 봅시다. 네, 그러면 우선 각자의 영토를 소개해보는 시간을 가져보려고 해요. 지금 저희가 함께 미로보드를 보고 있는데 네, 미로보드는 이렇게 생겼어요. 지금 각자의 영토가 동그라미 모양으로 나눠져 있는데 한 명씩 돌아가면서 한번 영토에 대한 소개를 조금 해주시면 좋을 것 같아요. 그래서 박창수 선생님께서 정말 많은 프로젝트를 알려주셨는데 그 중에 딱 두 개만 골라서 한번 설명을 먼저 해주시면 어떨까?
이게 그 지금 사진에 보여지는 게 제가 이제 프로젝트를 했던 내용을 설명한다기보다는 어쨌든 뭐 지역에 들어가서 사람들과 만나고 뭐 그 어쨌든 관계를 맺게 되고 이렇게 되는데 전혀 의도치 않았던 사람들을 또 만나게 되는 것 같아요. 근데 그 중에 하나가 되게 흥미롭게 봤던 게 거기가 이제 광릉내라고 하는 엄청나게 이렇게 그 자연이 우리나라에서 잘 보존된 이런 데인데 아파트가 들어오면서 생기는 여러 가지 문제들이 있어요. 근데 그 아파트에 들어오신 분들이 아직 아파트를 만들려고 이렇게 다져놓은 땅, 엄청 자갈을 넣어서 다져놓은 땅을 그 동네 그 새로 입주한 아파트에서 들어온 할머니가 이제 할머니들이 뭐 여기저기 그 다져놓은 땅을 막 발굴해내는 땅에 흙은 별로 없고 거의 자갈인데 그 자갈들을 이렇게 다 뭐랄까 이렇게 땅 흙에 약간의 흙들을 남기고 자갈들을 이렇게 걸러내서 그거를 이제 성처럼 옆에 쌓고 그 다음에 거기다가 이제 뭔가 먹을 수 있는 전부 다 먹을 수 있는 어떤 것들을 이제 재배하는 이런 거 그래서 자기들이 시골에서 열심히 이제 땅을 만들고 거기서 뭔가 길러 먹던 이런 것들을 이제 이동해 와서도 이제 지속하는 이런 걸 보였는데 특히 이 사진에 여기 있는 사진에 있는 거는 그 할머니 한 분이 이제 그 한 60대나 70대 초반쯤 돼 보이시는 할머니인데 어느 날 보니까 그 휠체어에 그 90대 노모를 이제 모시고 나와가지고 그분은 못 움직이시니까 그 옆에 이제 세워두고 또 어느 날은 주로 주말에 그 딸, 근데 그 따님이 이제 새로 결혼한 것 같고 그 따님이 또 이제 한 두세 살 되는 또 딸을 이제 낳아서 이렇게 4대의 딸이 이제 그 여자분들이 모여가지고 거기서 뭔가 농사를 짓는 걸 봤었는데 그래서 이제 우리가 제가 이제 거기서 말을 붙이고 뭐 이렇게 하면서 좀 친해졌었습니다. 근데 그때 그 굉장히 특별한 모습이었고 그 다음에 제가 약간의 그 거기다가 아 그럼 나도 여기 뭘 심겠다 그래가지고 그분들이 파는 게 너무 힘들어 보여가지고 저는 이제 약간 종이컵이나 뭐 이런 걸 모아가지고 그거에 밑둥을 잘라버리고 거기에다 뭘 약간 꽃을 심었어요. 꽃을 뭘 심으면 좋겠냐 그랬더니 꽃을 심으면 좋겠다 이러시더라고요. 근데 자기가 만든 땅에는 절대 꽃을 심으면 안 돼요. 거기는 반드시 먹을 수 있는 뭔가를 심어야 되고 옆에서 관계없는 땅에 한다면 니네는 꽃을 심어주면 좋겠다 뭐 이런 거거든요. 굉장히 특별한 흥미로웠는데 그래서 우리가 약간의 그 무슨 꽃이었는지 잘 기억도 안 나는데 아마 뭐 민들레 그런 아 뭐 옆에 있는 뭐 잡초의 꽃 같은 것들을 옮겨다 심기도 했고 뭐 이랬던 것 같아요. 근데 어쨌든 그분들은 발굴을 했다면 저는 이제 종이컵에 흙을 담고 종이컵 밑둥을 잘라버리고 거기다 심으니까 그 이제 꽃이 뿌리가 이제 바닥으로 자기가 알아서 이제 들어갈 거다 뭐 이런 방식이죠. 그래서 이제 게으른 자의 어떤 방식인데 어쨌든 그 남양주에서 했던 거는 그 정도 얘기를 말씀을 드리고요.
김철우 대표님도 아주 간단히 그 용동물산 장려운동에 대해서 소개를 해주셨는데 조금 더 자세히 어떤 프로젝트였는지 알려주시면 좋을 것 같아요. 그리고 또 돌아와요 부산항의 프로젝트도 소개하고 싶다고 하셨는데 되게 궁금합니다.
네, 아까 말씀드린 것처럼 용도라고 하는 지역이 가지고 있는 여러 가지 그 당시의 문제들을 정부나 아니면 기관이 만들어 가는 도시 계획이나 대응에 대한 것보다 주변에 있는 사람들이나 거기서 살고 있는 사람들의 혹은 생활하고 있는 사람들의 움직임이 훨씬 더 중요할 거라고 생각을 해서 이제 그런 움직임을 만들어내는 시작점을 직접 나서서 해보고 싶다는 생각이 들었었고요. 그래서 이제 용도에 비어있는 공장이나 아니면 유휴부지들을 중심으로 이제 거기에서 무언가 그 공간들을 쓰는 일들을 시작했고요. 이제 첫 번째 했던 게 조선 기자재 업체의 비어있는 공장과 사무실을 활용해서 거기에 이제 엔지니어들이나 디자이너들이 모여서 원래는 조선 관련돼 있는 엔지니어링이나 아니면 디자인을 했던 분들이 제가 이제 아젠다를 도시에 관련된 아젠다를 가지고 오거나 아니면 진짜 일을 가지고 와서 그 문제를 어떻게 풀 것인가에 대한 고민을 이제 해나가는 그런 방식으로 메이커 스페이스 역할을 하는 일종의 스튜디오를 운영을 했었고요. 이제 그러면서 고민했던 부분이 그렇게 해서 일학원 키워드로 측면으로 여튼 여러 가지 다른 방법의 활동들을 좀 전환시키는 그래서 진짜 움직임을 다시 만들어 나가는 걸 하다 보니 일뿐만 아니라 이제 여가도 아주 중요한 것이 될 거고 그런데 이제 여가라고 하는 것이 그냥 과연 소비만 하는 일로 끝나는 것이 과연 맞는가 흔히 말하는 돈을 주고 뭔가 문화나 아니면 상품을 혹은 서비스를 사거나 아니면 소비하는 걸로 여가를 즐긴다라고 하는 것만 여가라고 말하기에는 너무 부족한 것 같다는 생각이 들었고요. 그래서 여가라는 그 어떤 키워드를 가지고 생산자와 소비자가 경계가 되게 모호해지는 그런 점을 좀 만들고 싶었어요. 그래서 지금 오른쪽 사진에서 보시는 것처럼 그 바닷가에 있는 창고를 아주 소극적으로 이제 개조를 한 다음에 여기에서 문화 공연이나 아니면 전시 같은 걸 했고요. 이제 거기서 같이 교환할 수 있었던 건 주변의 엔지니어나 디자이너들은 새로운 영감을 받을 수 있는 일종의 소비자가 되는데 거기에 생산자가 되는 분들은 아티스트들이나 기획자 중에서 다른 화이트 큐브에서 하기 어려운 이제 전시나 아니면 공연을 해보고 싶었지만 못하고 있는 것들을 할 수 있는 기회를 드리는 것 이렇게 해서 생산자 측면이 기획자와 아티스트들은 자기가 하고 싶었던 걸 해보면서 사람들이 어떤 반응을 보이는지에 대한 피드백을 받을 수 있는 공간으로 만들었고 또 이제 디자이너나 이제 엔지니어들은 다른 데서 보지 못했던 새로운 걸 보험으로 인해서 자기의 작업이나 아니면 프로젝트에 영감을 받아가는 이런 구조를 만들어서 생산자와 소비자 또는 각자의 다음 단계를 위한 만나서 연결되는 지점으로 만들어주는 이런 프로젝트를 했었고요. 이제 그 이후에 주거라고 하는 키워드를 가지고 산비탈에 있는 마을, 상계석에 있는 마을에서 빈 공간들 또는 빈 집들을 가지고 혹은 필요하다면 약간의 무단 점거 아주 짧은 시간 동안의 무단 점거를 통해서 어떻게 쓰고 있지 않은 또는 잘 쓰이고 있지 않은 공간들을 잠시나마 활용할 수 있는가 시간성이라고 하는 걸 물론 제한을 해서 할 수 있는가 이런 것들을 이제 테스트해보는 그래서 그림에서 보시면 도로를 아주 짧은 시간 동안 활용해서 영화를 보는 그런 산비탈이라고 하는 것 그리고 도로라고 하는 것이 가지는 여러 가지 악조건들을 혹은 쓰임새가 매우 제한되어 있는 것들을 어떻게 그 활용성을 넓힐 수 있는가라고 하는 걸 해보는 한 상징적인 하나의 프로젝트였다고 생각할 수 있을 것 같고요. 이제 그리고 대부분의 도시계획이나 기관들의 프로젝트들이 너무나 거시를 위주로 해서 그 시간성으로도 그렇고 그 다음에 실제 규모로 스케일로 봐도 그렇고 너무 거시적이어서 이제 이걸 얼마나 더 미시적으로 혹은 세세하게 쪼갤 수 있을까에 대한 부분을 좀 고민해서 지금 아래 위에 보시는 것처럼 주변에 나는 고사리류나 이끼류들의 식물이라든지 아니면 사람들이 계속 버리고 버려서 이제 생기는 여러 가지 다양한 흔히 말하는 쓰레기들이 어떻게 이제 우리 주변에 존재하는지 또는 그 안에 시간성 즉 다시 말하면 예전에 생산되어서 썼던 거지만 지금은 쓰지 않는 것들이 이미 주변에 계속해서 이제 생기고 있으니까 이제 그런 것들 안에서 어떻게 우리는 시간성을 조금이라도 다시 되새길 수 있을까 이런 것들을 계속 이제 미시적으로 쪼갰던 이런 작업을 했었고요. 이제 그게 이제 돌아올 부산항해라는 프로젝트였는데 이제 그 프로젝트를 하다 보니 이렇게 이제 계속 미시적으로 쪼개가서 지역에 국한되는 것이 과연 어떤 또 다음 단계를 이어갈 수 있는 지속 가능성을 담보할 수 있을까라고 고민을 하다가 그렇다면 이런 특수성이나 이런 특별한 개별성도 결국은 보편성이랑 연결되어야지만 더 큰 의미를 가질 것 같다는 생각이 들어서 그럼 이걸 다른 지역과 어떻게 연계하거나 뭐 이게 확장이라는 개념이 막 더 키워간다 이런 개념이라기보다는 다른 지역 또는 다른 시대와 어떻게 연결할 것인가라는 측면에서 이제 고민들을 하는 것이 지금 영도물산 장려회관이라는 프로젝트고요. 이제 그런데 그게 그냥 개념으로만 가긴 좀 뭐 제가 생각하는 바는 개념과 실체가 저는 결합되어야 된다 생각을 해서 이제 그 개념을 녹여내는 건축물이나 아니면 공간들을 계속 만들어가는 그런 과정이 있습니다.
제가 소개하는 프로젝트는 아직 현재 리서치 단계에 있어서 결과물이 향후에 어떤 방식으로 진행될지는 조금 더 두고 봐야 될 것 같아요. 현재 하고 있는 그 리서치는 어번 드리프트라는 이름으로 네, 리트레이싱 뷰로라는 네, 앞서서 이제 소개드렸던 컬렉티브에서 하고 있는 리서치이고요. 그 리서치 이미지도 이제 제가 세계의 야자수 이미지를 가지고 왔거든요. 네, 아마 이 야자수는 네, 이러한 어떤 지역성과는 어떻게 연관되는 건가 좀 다들 궁금해하실 것 같아요. 오히려 우리가 지속하고 조금 더 확장해야 되는 지역성의 반대편에서 오는 하나의 저는 좀 위협적인 어떤 지역성을 변형시키거나 지역성을 매우 유연한 방식으로 이렇게 다르게 이제 변화시켜가는 하나의 방식이라고 보고 있는데요. 유럽에서는 팬데믹이 굉장히 오랫동안 있었고 도시 봉쇄들이 있었죠. 그래서 이제 도시 봉쇄가 해제되는 시점마다 정부에서 이제 공공 영역과 뭐 상권을 활성화하기 위한 정책들을 계속해서 제안을 해왔어요. 그 중에 하나가 이제 내부 공간 영업이 어렵기 때문에 외부에서 이제 카페 테라스 영업을 할 수 있다는 거였고 그렇게 해서 굉장히 많은 상권에서 앞에 이제 테라스들이 만들어졌고 그때의 사실 야자수는 하나의 장식적인 요소로서 이제 화분들이 굉장히 많이 준비를 됐었죠. 그래서 당시 팬데믹 기간 동안에 기하급수적으로 이제 증가한 야자수들을 보면서 이 야자수들의 어떤 배경은 도대체 어디서 오는 것인가 라는 질문들을 하게 됐었는데요. 아무래도 오늘 또 네, 라이스브링 시스터즈 클럽의 그 네, 지역성과 하나 이동성 모빌리티라는 요소가 있는데 그러한 모빌리티가 마비됐을 때 우리가 움직이지 못했을 때 그 이상적인 장소로서의 뭔가 열대 이국적인 정치라는 것에 대한 이상향 그 동향이 굉장히 컸던 것 같아요. 그래서 그런 것들을 사실상 더 사람들을 더 이렇게 고취하고 상업적으로 사실 이끄는 방식으로서 야자수들이 이제 등장했던 거죠. 그런데 그 이후에 계속해서 봉쇄령이 지속이 되면서 계속해서 결국엔 사람들이 사용하지 못하는 장소들의 야자수들이 심어지게 되거든요. 그래서 결국에는 굉장히 많은 일종의 식재 플랜팅을 통해서 상업적인 혹은 경제적으로 활성화하고자 하는 전략들이 실패를 했고 이제 전면적인 그 봉쇄 이후에 이제 재개장했을 때 풍경이 밑에 있는 그 맥도날드에서 앞에 있는 야자수 이미지인데요. 네, 더 그런 이국 정치를 네, 더 적극적으로 사용하고자 하는 상업적인 목적에 의해서 이제 퍼져나가는 산하의 팬데믹 이후에 사람들의 어떤 이상향에 대한 키워드로서 등장한 이미지로서 이제 야자수를 도시 안에서 봤었고 이와 관련해서 최근에 지역에서도 많은 변화들이 일어나고 있는 것 같아요. 그래서 왼쪽에 있는 이미지가 한국의 이제 여수거든요. 여수의 이제 향이람 네, 절 근처의 이미지인데 최근에 생기고 있는 새로운 어떤 게스트하우스는 호텔 앞에 야자수들이 계속 심어지고 있더라고요. 그리고 심지어는 뭐 폐교 같은 경우에도 이제 좀 문화재생을 통해서 네, 많은 네, 폐교 활용 정책들이 있었는데 그 앞에도 이제 야자수들이 다시 심어지고 있는데 이런 그 지역 안에서 지역에서의 변화들, 그러니까 야자수라는 굉장히 작은 하나의 식물이기는 하지만 그것이 보여지고 있는 지금 현재 우리가 부여하고 있는 지역성이라는 것은 어떤 것인가라는 질문을 계속 하게 되는 것 같아요. 그 지역성은 현실에서의 어떤 지역성과는 다른 그러니까 뭔가 광역권 혹은 도심이라는 곳에서 볼 수 없는 되게 먼 장소에 대한 어떤 이상향으로서 그것을 반영하는 수단으로서 야자수를 심고 있는 게 아닌가라는 그런 좀 약간 비판적인 네, 입장에서 이 조사를 계속 하고 있고 저는 조금은 네, 다른 그러니까 지금 현재 동시대 사회에서 지역성을 변형시키는 하나의 장치로서 나자수를 라는 어떤 이미지를 가져와 봤습니다. 네.
네, 감사합니다. 갑자기 이제 여기저기 다니면서 보아왔던 야자수들이 막 다 스쳐 지나가는.
심지어 저는 최근에 만든 공간에 야자수
붙이는데
엄청 부끄럽네요.
네, 가겠습니다. 네.
네, 시간이 좀 흐르고 이게 대부분 뭐 몇십 년, 뭐 한국은 뭐 몇 년일 수도 있는데 금방금방 뭐 하는 곳이 변하잖아요. 그랬을 때 그 심어진 야자수는 뭐 어떻게 될까 뭐 이런 생각도 들어요. 보통의 나무들하고 좀 달라서.
맞아요. 네. 네.
감사합니다. 마지막으로 짧게 저희 라이스브링 시스터즈가 준비했던 흙을 간단히 설명하고 네, 좀 더 이어가 보도록 하겠습니다. 저희는 두 가지 흙을 준비했는데요. 하나는 이제 인도네시아에서 이제 저희가 사용했던 흙이고 하나는 안성의 저희 텃밭의 흙이에요. 이 흙흙랜드라는 프로젝트가 사실 인도네시아의 자티왕의 아트팩토리라는 곳에서 이제 시작이 돼서 같이 소개를 하려고 합니다. 자티왕의 아트팩토리는 이제 원래 벽도 기와를 만드는 만들면서 이제 생계를 유지하던 마을이에요. 그래서 그런 곳에서 이제 아트 문화 공간이 생기고 뭔가 마을의 기와 공장의 비즈니스가 쇠퇴되고 있는데 그러한 역사와 문화들을 같이 포용하면서 앞으로의 문화 이제 마을로서의 도시 재생에 참여할 수 있는 여러 방식을 좀 시도하고 있는 공간이고 저희도 뭔가 그 과정을 한번 같이 경험해 보자 해서 인도네시아에서는 이제 그 농사에서 난 음식의 쓰레기를 저희가 모으고 그거를 농부님들께 퇴비화하는 방식을 배우고 그거를 다시 이제 농사에서 그거 모은 영양가 없는 땅에 돌려주는 그런 작업을 했었어요. 근데 그거를 한 2개월 안에 한번 경험을 했었는데 그것을 이제 한국에서 1년의 시간 동안 우리가 약간 수행하는 마음으로 한번 실천을 해보자 해서 무엇을 배우고 뭘 해볼 수 있을지 좀 상상을 해봤으면 좋겠다 해서 이제 시작한 게 저희 흑흑랜드 작업입니다.
저희가 이제 흙이라는 물질을 처음 대했을 때 이것을 어떻게 저희에게는 일종의 이제 작업 재료로서 흙을 대하게 됐고 이 흙을 그래서 어떻게 봐야 될 것인가라는 생각을 먼저 했던 것 같아요. 그래서 사실 흙을 통해서 생물체와의 공동체도 있지만 또 생물체 안에서 그 저희가 인간 외의 것들의 어떤 관계, 그 다음에 인간들과의 관계들이 점점 확장해 나간다고 생각을 했어요. 그래서 저희의 흙은 어떻게 보면 그 기본 작은 물질에서부터 확장되어 나간 어떤 공동체를 다르게 만날 수 있는 방식이었다고 생각이 돼요. 그래서 저희가 궁금했던 점은 각각의 프로젝트들이 굉장히 다른 방식으로 지역과 아까 저희가 이제 비유적으로 흙이라고 각각의 흙 영토에서의 이제 그 방식들이 있는데 어떤 방식으로 지역에서 공동체들을 만나게 됐고 그 공동체들은 사실 어떤 특색을 가지고 있는지 그런 이야기들을 조금 더 들어보고자 합니다. 네.
제가 느끼기에는 작가들이 이제 어디에 들어가면 보통 일방적으로 그 지역성에 일단 지역성에 뭐랄까 순화돼야 되고 그래서 그분들을 존중해야 되고 그러면서 이제 그 어쨌든 지속적으로 만들어져 왔던 문화에 어쨌든 존중해야 된다 이런 얘기를 많이 하잖아요. 근데 실제로는 그런 것들이 사적 이익을 관철하기 위한 방식으로 엄청나게 작동을 해요. 그리고 굉장히 권력이 엄청 권력이 작동하는 방식이 있어요. 그래서 주민 권력도 있고 뭐 개인에 따라 다르긴 하지만 또 행정 권력도 있고 아무튼 지역적인 어떤 그런 것도 있고 그런 것들이 대부분 지금 현재 한국 사회에서 그런 것들이 긍정적인가 그렇게 봤을 때 그 뭐랄까 다른 차원에서 볼 필요도 있는 것 같아요. 그러니까 살아온 걸 무시하거나 뭐 이런 측면에서가 아니라 그런 것들이 현재 그 진짜 공공적으로 바람직한가 아니면 사적으로 내가 필요로 하고 내가 취향을 가진 존재로서 그것들을 서로 존중하면서 작동하고 있나 이런 측면에서 좀 다시 봐야 되지 않나 이런 생각을 하게 됐습니다. 네.
네, 저는 그 다른 지금 분들 말씀하신 것과 조금 다르게 뭐 정확히 공동체 활동을 하는 것은 아니어서 오히려 뭐 할 말이 많지는 않은데요. 그냥 어쨌든 제가 보고 있는 공동체는 어떤 특정한 목적이나 아니면 어떤 지향점 아니면 맥락 안에서 인위적으로든 아니면 자연스럽게 자연 발생적으로든 묶었거나 아니면 묶여 있는 일종의 개별성들의 연결이라고 생각을 하거든요. 그래서 창국 선생님이 말씀하셨던 것처럼 그것이 묶여져서 어떤 권력을 이제 가지게 되는 것 자체가 그 선으로 이제 그냥 선으로 인식되는 것은 그렇게 썩 좋은 건 아니라는 생각을 일단 하고 있고요. 이제 그런 의미에서 저희는 되게 강력하게 묶여 있는 공동체나 연합에 대한 걸 그렇게 썩 선호하지 않습니다. 제가 하는 그 공간이나 아니면 작업하면서도 가능하다면 느슨하게 또는 개별성을 최대한 존중하는 선에서 목적지나 아니면 그 맥락만 정확히 그 얘기하거나 아니면 이렇게 지정하도록 하고요. 그다음에 이제 그 안에서도 지정한 안에서도 결국은 언제든 들어왔다 나갔다 할 수 있는 예, 그래서 그 거기에 동의하는 사람들만 한시적으로 그런 것들을 할 수 있는 일종의 팝업 같은 형태의 연대나 아니면 공동체를 저는 조금 더 많이 실험해 보는 것 같습니다.
감사합니다. 흙과 땅에 대해서 생각한 지 2년 정도밖에 되지 않았지만 그 과정에서 흙의 입자 하나하나 그리고 그게 땅이 되는 과정 이런 것들이 저희한테 의미하는 바가 되게 달라졌다면 달라졌을 수도 있을 것 같아요. 그 무게를 알게 되는 시간이었다고도 할 수 있을 것 같고 그래서 처음에는 흙 입자와 우리 세포 사이의 어떤 교류 그래서 굉장히 미시적인 접근으로 시작을 했던 것 같아요. 어떻게 우리가 몸으로 그리고 몸에서 조금은 더 망각되어 왔던 감각과 우리가 흙이 어떻게 관련을 맺고 있지? 그래서 시각뿐만이 아니라 촉각, 미각, 후각 그리고 어떤 공감각까지 생각을 해보기도 했고 이런 워크숍을 아시아의 여러 지역에서도 했었는데 그때마다 흙과 땅을 가져오는 종류들도 너무 다르고 하게 되는 이야기들도 되게 다르더라고요. 예를 들어서 인도네시아 족자카르타에 있는 어떤 참여자와 얘기를 했을 때 그때는 족자카르타에 신공항을 짓고 난개발이 일어나고 있는 상황에서 소장농 소유의 땅들이 하나씩 하나씩 국가에 빼앗겨가는 상황에서 토지주권 이야기를 하지 않을 수가 없겠더라고요. 그런 생각도 하게 되는 반면 그래서 어떻게 보면 억압의 기제로서 혹은 어떤 권력이 수탈을 하는 기제로서 흙과 땅을 사용하기도 한다면 다른 방향으로 봤을 때는 내가 이주를 하게 될 수밖에 없는 상황에 있어서 이주를 하게 됐는데 고향의 기억을 가져가고자 그리고 그 물질적 표상을 가져가고자 흙을 한 줌 가져간다든지 그런 참여자도 있었어요. 그래서 흙의 이주를 되게 여러 방식으로 그리고 여러 힘의 역학에서 생각해 볼 수 있다는 질문을 하게 된 것 같아요.
흙을 많은 사람들이 떠오르면 뭐 저도 포함해서 더 이상 이제 현실적인 매우 가까운 일상 속의 물질이라고 생각하기는 쉽지 않은 것 같아요. 그 이유 중에 하나는 너무나 많은 사람들이 도시에 살고 있고 실제로 도시와 가정이 전 지구의 80%라고 하는데 그 도시와 가정이라고 하면 한국은 90%가 넘고요. 하면 사실 결국은 흙을 개간해서 계속해서 개조해서 하나의 그쵸? 네. 시멘트를 덮고 콘크리트를 덮어서 건물을 만들고 일종의 그런 기반수를 만들어서 사람들이 살 수 있는 환경을 만드는 건데 심지어는 이제 뭐 그린 뉴딜이라는 말로 해서 그쵸 환경을 자연 환경을 더 보기 좋고 인간에게 더 친숙한 방식으로 개조하는 작업 하고 있잖아요. 그럼 결국에는 인류의 서사는 계속 진흙을 개조하는 과정에 와 있었고 그렇기 때문에 도시 안에서의 그 흙 특히 진흙은 만날 수가 너무 없는 그렇게 되어온 것 같습니다. 그래서 최근에는 그 흙이 가지고 있는 저항성에 대해 관심을 많이 갖고 있고요. 특히 뭐 제가 네 아직 참여 조금 더 이제 너무나도 미술계 안에서 활동을 하다 보니까 조금 더 사회적인 네, 운동의 입장에서 관심을 갖고 있는 운동들은 이제 커먼즈 운동들 관심 많고 그 한국에서의 그 공덕동에서 결국에는 그쵸 정책과 그런 네 상업적인 목적에 의해서 실패한 운동이 돼버린 경희 공유주의 운동을 네 되게 떠올렸었거든요. 그래서 정말로 그 도시적 삶에서 가지고 있는 흙의 저항성이 이 도시적 삶을 위협하는 하나의 네 그 작은 흙의 입자라는 게 하나의 위협이 대상이 되고 있고 이것들을 저항의 힘으로 도모하려는 것들이 필요하겠다라는 생각을 가지고 있습니다. 그래서 네 그래서 많은 이제 라이스브링 시스터즈 클럽도 마찬가지고 네 박장국 대표님이나 김철우 대표님도 마찬가지로 이렇게 지역에서 네, 공동체와 그 지역에서의 여러 자원들을 사실 지속하고 그것들을 확장하고 연결하는 방식에 관심을 가지신 분들과 앞으로 더 좀 소통을 하고자 하는 네, 그런 네, 저의 바람입니다.
네. 네, 저는 이제 실제 농사를 지으면서 이제 소연 씨가 말씀했던 이제 감각이라는 것이 제가 지역성을 좀 더 다시 정의하게 된 큰 계기가 됐던 것 같아요. 그래서 말씀해 주셨던 그런 무지역성, 이제 야자수가 여기 원래 나는 게 아닌데 그냥 당연하게 받아들었던 저와 이제 뭔가 농사를 하면서 좀 다른 것들이 보이는 그런 감각이 생기는 거, 그런 점들이 좀 더 다시 상기되는 시간이었습니다. 그래서 감사합니다.
네, 그러면 이렇게 이동하는 흙 라운드 테이블을 마무리하도록 하겠습니다. 네, 라운드 테이블을 통해서 각자 읽어오신 흙과 영토가 공동의 영토로 만나는 접합지점을 만들 수 있었기를 바라면서 네, 참여에 감사의 말씀을 전합니다.
감사합니다. 랜선도 재밌네요. 그럼 다음에 봐요.
네, 네. 들어가세요.
감사합니다. 수고 많으셨습니다.
감사합니다.
네.
Hi everyone. We're back after the recorded presentation, and so we will talk for about 20 minutes amongst ourselves, the presenters, and we'll open up the floor to the questions from the general public and other presenters. Okay, so wow, mind-blowing presentations, and they were all fantastic, multifaceted, and we could go into multiple directions in terms of discussions, because in order to explain to us, the rest of us, your practice, you had to also inform us about the history and the social context, sometimes very long history of urban development in Seoul, in the case of Eunsan's presentation, or the changing social situations in Incheon, in the case of Eun-gi. There were moments of self-defeat, And as Eunsun said, gloomy, emotional response. I was vividly remembering the first time I went to Naesongcheon with the group, including Eunsun, back in 2011, and also joining Seoul tours in the early years. The tour itself, in the guise of a fun activity, was very much emotional as well. But there was humor, so I really liked kind of the play of the words that Eunggi, you brought in all of your projects, turning misul, fine arts, into misul, fine alcohol, fine wine. That was a great touch. So because I'm a historian, I just wanted to historically contextualize what in South Korea is discussed in terms of 공공미술, or public art. The history of public art as discussed as 공공미술 in South Korea only begins after the institutional democratization, so after institution of parliamentary democracy. So we're talking about mid to late 1990s. So I was pleased to see how Eunggi's project actually began from that phase. In 1995 with 지역 미술 연구 모임, right? So that was great to make a note. And so what characterizes 공공미술 phase and Korean participatory art, which is very much different from, in fact, the period of my specialization, 1970s and 80s and early 90s, where artistic practices merged with social activism in very different ways. So what characterizes this phase that I think all of your collectives belong to is that in the absence of consensus, artists are still arguing for the power of collective production and collaboration. And I also noticed, running thread of perseverance and resourcefulness in all of your practices. So here comes my first question. What sustains you? What gets you going? So it might be a different question for each of you. I understand that. So for Eunggi, I wanted you to talk a little bit about the 1995 local art study group, 지역 미술 연구 모임, as a genesis of your practice, and how it had to transform over the years. You told us a little bit more about the final decade, starting from 2007, but could you contextualize present day practice within this very, very long sustained practice of yours? And for Eunsun, seems like your practice, your lens to the city as a collective migrates to different sites of resistance. So when you find a new site of resistance and a site that requires your attention, how do you move to the next site? What happens to the old site? So I guess I'm asking about the genesis and also shifts. And for Soyun, nice to meet you, Rice Spring Sisters Club, since you are very new, I wonder what was the impetus for your group to start a new collective when it seems like there are so many other collectives? And that was very obvious from your social fermentation roundtable. The roundtable was fantastic, but at the same time, I think I would love to learn more about the three sisters in the club. And so what was your first project? And how do you sustain yourselves? It seems like you have a lot of overseas projects as well. Okay, so I'll stop there for the first question.
네, 제가 먼저 답변 드리면 될까요?
Should I go first? 네. All right.
너무나 좋게 보아주셔서 감사드립니다.
thank you for your appreciation of my work. I couldn't quite elaborate earlier. So as you mentioned, we started in 1995, the local arts study group. And this is where we are today. At that time, the impetus or the background behind forming this group was that, as for me, I majored in art in a rather well-known university in Seoul. Everybody wanted to be famous in art school, and everybody wanted to stay in Seoul after graduation, that is. So after my graduation, I came back to Incheon, which was where I grew up. And so it had a huge influence on me, Incheon, that is. Again, it was so, everything was so centralized in Seoul area. Everybody became so competitive to win, to become so-called famous or to succeed in Seoul. So within me, I had a kind of a desire, a kind of a need to get away from the logic, the custom of the time. I wanted to go against the trend. So I didn't want to be part of the competition. I guess I have that kind of character in me. I wanted to go against it, against the trend, against the mainstream. And on the other hand, also, Incheon was the kind of a shadow of this system. So I want to come to the shadow, which was Incheon, and find what I can do as an artist in Incheon locally. And that's how I began the local study group and seeking what we can do, how we can practice. And so that's, then so power was concentrated on minority of the group in Incheon, we discovered. Moderator mentioned before 1990s. So as you know, 1990s was when local autonomy in Korea began, which was to get away from the centralized system, centralized power in Korea. So the idea was to compete from regions competing each other. And each local government used art as a sort of an instrument of competition with other cities. For example, they also used the logic of capital to make a city into a brand. So that was what was going on at that time. So that's what we witnessed. And that was, and so Pedari, the site that I mentioned earlier with the expressway, was symbolic of what all that was going on. I only introduced you one story, but there were other projects, other urban regeneration projects. It's called New Town Projects. There were six such projects going on in Incheon alone, which I did not mention in my presentation. So looking at this, I was looking at small monopoly of powers, private powers controlling the city and having huge influence on the people who have been living there for a long time and being evicted from where they have been living and having influence on the natural resources as well as the human, the culture and the memories that people have. So I felt that I had to resist this. So you asked me what sustains me. A lot of people ask me what sustains me for so long. Whether it's a village or a city, I do have an ambition to realize a city that I envision, to realize a village. And I also want to be free from any kind of power or force. That's the desire within me to be autonomous, to live an autonomous life. And so that's, I guess, the energy for me to go on and for me to go against the logic, the external logic of life. I want to have my own logic. I want to have an influence on the space that I live in. I want to discover and to go beyond and to find something alternative and to share my vision with others. And that's the will that I have, I guess, within me. So that's it.
Thank you so much. Yeah, the photographs that you shared with the playground and the kids, when I saw those photos, I really wanted to, if I ever moved to Korea, I wanted to move to your neighborhood. So yeah, Eun-san, do you have a response to my question?
Yeah, actually, when you start your movement, we never quit. We must not quit. When you think you cannot finish it, you even shouldn't really start it. This is about responsibility. So many artists, they just come and go and take pictures and make installations and go. That's really like rude, actually. They using this, you know, activism for their fame and just disappearing. So I have seen that so many times. So for example, Naesung River, we started in 2009 and we're still doing that. And Okbara Jelly, it was quite short and Doribam finished it. But for Cheonggyecheon, we, you know, about research about Cheonggyecheon, we started in 2009 and we still deeply involved with that redevelopment project, but which is not, you know, easy. For example, especially Cheonggyecheon movement is really tough because there are so many people we care now. We help merchants, at least 1,000 people at the moment, and especially now at least 200 people, like we are helping over 200 people's lawsuit out of 6 people. So it's, which is really crazy. So it's really stressful, and we fight against the developers. Developers are really smart and evil. You know, evils are smart. So it's really difficult to maintain our activities. Eun-gi came to Cheonggyecheon once, right? But anyway, it's really difficult to maintain our activities, but we try our best to do our, you know, responsibility. Yeah, and that actually that sustains us. You know, we want to kid all the time, and it's really stressful because someone asked me about, I lost the question. Yeah. Someone asked me about governance. Yeah, Yoon-kyung Im. Yeah, governance participation. I will answer that too. You know, like actually governance is very important. And then in Korean redevelopment process, actually citizens cannot know the process. That's really problematic. And you know, so activists like us, if we don't help them, they will never know the process. And especially legally, there are so many, you know, traps that you can trap. So if we don't help, that you cannot really win. And especially governance, there is no governance in the redevelopment process. But we tried to make governance in the redevelopment process. But usually, Cheonggyecheon is a little different because we are here and we're working really hard and we fight against Seoul City and Jung-guk, the, you know. But usually city and developers, they working together and they pretend the citizen participation, they pretending it, and actually they don't do it. They don't like, you know, like talking with citizens or residents. So it's so yeah, yes. So that's why we wanted to help the residents and the evictees. Otherwise, there's no one really can help. So, and about redevelopment, you need kind of expert knowledge. Even lawyers don't know about the process well. And like professors at urban planning, I don't think they know about it because they never have a, like lived experience. So like you can say armchair anthropology, here's an armchair urban planning here. So it's really annoying. So we need people, we need more people like Ungi and, you know, Changgaechan, which is not easy. Yeah.
So I guess
you
are saying that you never leave the site of struggle. When you start, it's part of your larger being.
If I can, I want to leave for sure. So I never look at it back. For example, Oparaji Alley was so traumatic. You know, yeah. It was so lucky no one really died there. It was almost killed, you know, we almost killed there. So yeah. That's really traumatic. So I don't even look at that in part, you know, I never stop at the Dongnim station because it was so traumatic. So when it finishes, we never look at that. But as long as we care about some place, we try to, you know, protect them as much as we can.
Mm-hmm. Well, so completing it, finishing it, it's not by your will. It happens because the site is gone. Or
yes, or
the eviction is complete.
Yeah, or you know, like struggle finishes. You know, that usually that's willing of evictees, usually not our wish. You know, because they are tired and they want to finish their struggle, and then it finishes. So, and then we have to follow their will actually. So this is totally their will. So we cannot force them to resist more. Like, we should do more, you know, we cannot resist that.
Thank you. Yeah, so Soyun from Rice Brewing Sisters Club.
Yeah, thanks Professor Lee for your question. Nice to meet you too.
Call me Sol.
Hi Sol, do you hear me or am I echoing? Okay, yeah, so I guess we talked a lot about a bunch of synergistic energy, but we actually didn't get a chance to talk about ourselves so much. So we are a fairly new collective, as you said. We started in 2018. I wasn't part of it, actually. So it's kind of a constantly in flux, morphing kind of entity. Sorry, I'm just gonna...
Sorry, I kept hearing myself. Do you hear me now? Okay. We started pretty organically, if that's the right way to call it. We all come different backgrounds. Hemin Sun comes from a visual arts background. Elithia Hyunjin Shin, she was involved in community-centered practices and exhibition planning. And I mainly work with text and concepts. So we all come from really different backgrounds and stories. And I think we were figuring out a way to be together and work together. So this really loose form of a collective, and we decided to call it a club because it didn't really have the characteristics that we might call a collective practice. And we also thought the collective is a really loaded word. So we wanted to do something different. At the first stage, it consisted of many temporary visits to those individuals who brewed rice wine. So we wanted to visit a lot of different rice brewers, not only in Korea, but also spread around in many locales in East Asia and Southeast Asia, because we thought they have a lot of similarities in terms of taste, smell, and then the process of making. So it really started from maybe tapping into new places, but really trying to learn skills and wisdoms that those brewers have to offer. So a lot of our first processes was learning. And then we started thinking about fermentation, the process itself, that it's not only biochemical or food related, but that could also be expanded into many different forms and scales. So what if we start brewing fermenting text? Or what if we start brewing relationships that we have with not only community partners, but also other collectives that are working with us? And sisters and friends seem like a good way to maybe define what we're doing. So we started building that kind of temporary sisterhood. So now we're doing a lot of different things. We just started having a small plot of land, 7평 of land. I'm not really sure how that is in US units, but really small. That was dedicated to growing native rice seeds that we exchanged with the sisters and friends we visited. So we wanted to kind of have that like life of seeds prolonged for many different generations. So we started actually farming, and that became maybe one of more permanent form of working, because land necessitates settling, and land also necessitated time being spent in that locality. So we are experimenting with ways to become permanent. And some of the institutional settings also make us be permanent. But I guess it's a little bit of a different approach that Inseon's I'm taking. And I really value the multiplicities that are brought into this platform.
Yeah. Thank you, Soyeon. So let me open the floor to questions that are flooding in the Q&A. Let me ask, actually one question that could be responded by all of you. So this was initially a question from Youngju Ryu for Eungi Min. How does Space Beam sustain itself financially? How can we help? But I want to ask this question also to Eunsan. How do you sustain the collective financially? Or how do you sustain yourself financially? Same question to Soyeon.
Actually, I finished my PhD at Urban Planning, and that's our engineering university. And Korean engineering university is famous for bad condition for working. So we call them ourselves as slaves. So I escaped slaverism. So slavery now, but also I'm bankrupt because I'm not a slave anymore. So I have more time, but I don't have money for sure. And I'm very sad, and I need like steady income. So I'm trying to find steady income. So that's why these days I make curries to sell. Like I'm a vegan, so I'm selling vegan curries, and like at weekends. I was like frustrated. Why did I PhD? If I'm making curries, so I was very sad. But anyway, it's good for them. And Cheonggyecheon Uchiro Bojeonnyeonde is also struggling. So that's why you should donate to Tumblebug. You go to Tumblebug and just please donate money. And then,
that will be great. Please post that link in the chat again so that it's visible to everyone. Yes. Thank you, Eunsan. Eungi, would you like to answer how you financially sustain your organization?
네, 저희 그 제가 스피스빔이 있는 그 양조장 건물이 규모가 좀 됩니다.
The brewery that I mentioned is the size is quite large, the facility. So as I mentioned, the rent is quite high there. As for my own living, I don't receive anything from a space beam, but we do have a paying staff, one person. So I am in charge. I have the responsibility to give her the monthly salary. Plus there's the operating cost. It's a huge place. So to secure finance, so there are two things that I have to do at the same time, financial responsibility plus the operations that the programs that I have to run. For the finance, we do receive support from the ARCO, the art commission. Of course, they don't give you automatically. You do have to produce results. So we do receive them. And as a nonprofit organization, we have that status and we do have support. So we don't receive any commercial donation, obviously. So because we're not a commercial organization, we do receive donation. About 70 to 80 people support us regularly. Those are small amounts that they give us. They make online deposit. And it really helps us greatly. Although it doesn't cover our rent, it does cover part of our rent. And we can't use the space 365 days because the place is huge. So the places that we don't use, the space that we don't use, we rent, sub-rent our space. Of course, not to everybody. We are quite selective in who we rent our sub-rent our place to. So we make money that way. Plus, our place is a great place for filming. So more and more, it's becoming more and more. So in January, February, when the finance is really difficult for us, it helps us great if somebody comes and does the film and pay us for the filming there. And so it's always like that. You know, you never know what's next, but somehow we make through. So the brewery, although it's old, it's quite attractive. We don't want it to go to a wrong owner. We don't want it to be demolished. So it's a big question for us. It's difficult to maintain, but we don't want to live there because we don't want it to go to a wrong person. We try to make it a kind of a public space with other organizations joining us so that we can run it together, but that didn't work out. We tried to perhaps buy the property with other people, but like I said, it hasn't worked out, but we're still looking into it, but without any certainty as of yet.
Thank you so much. So Soyun, your turn.
Yeah. We also apply to a lot of those public grants that Eun-gi was speaking about, but then there are major loopholes in those funding structures which don't assist artists themselves sustenance, and many other maintenance costs that go into the project. So there is a real need for us to have external funding structures or to work a lot of different part-time jobs in order to make our living beyond that public funding. Just the kind of nature that we operate, we host a lot of different platforms for chatting and working together on the farm, this mini farm that we made. And then that involves labor, which goes beyond us three. So we were trying to think of a flexible system where we can have labor force without, that doesn't involve so much currency as in terms of money. So we kind of do this really flexible structure of pumaji or 노동 교환, labor exchange, where we go to other people's farms and then we help them harvest, or we have them sow seeds, and then we have those small labors in return during our own harvest seasons. In terms of the platform, or in terms of hosting events like what we did digitally today, but we also do that a lot in person, and that involves a lot of food and cooking and drinks. So what we started doing was we brew our own rice wine, and with some of the harvest that's coming from our own farm, we cook food using that produce, so that we don't have to go to the grocery stores to buy those ingredients. So we try to sustain ourselves and have this micro self-sustenance structure in our small ways, but we have to think of a more institutional way to fund ourselves. Thanks.
That's great, thank you. So you are partially answering Sammy O's question about how would a physical in-person gathering would happen. What we saw digitally was metaphorically fantastic. It had visual translation of a social gathering to doodling together. So that was wonderful. But could you tell us a little bit more about a physical setting if a gathering were to happen for social fermentation?
Yeah. So maybe I can give you an example of hybrid format. We have been doing these workshops digitally for the past 2 years during the ongoing pandemic. And we try to mix the in-person element with the digital element. This one went completely digital. But for one of the workshops that we did in Gwangju Biennale last year, we sent little gurami package, a small package of produce coming from our own harvest, and the little seeds and goodies coming from our community partners. So we packed them into small gifts, and then we sent them all over Korea and some of our friends in Southeast Asia. And then we gathered with the same package. And then we did a digital gathering of unboxing it together. So that's kind of a mix between real, IRL, and digital. But before the pandemic, we would do a lot of those labor exchanges on our little land or farm. It has a small vinyl house that is normally used to grow, harvest, grow produce during the winter, but we would use it for gathering space. So people would come with their own potlucks, own food, and then we would basically have that workshop in that little space. And so it's a temporary space, but we use it to host a lot of gatherings. But that's also conversation plus labor work. Yeah.
That's great. So I want to ask two questions before we end the session within 6 minutes. So I would like you guys to answer quickly. But first, it's to Soyun. The question comes from Hoseok Kim about insurgent forces of the earth. How does hook become insurgent forces to transform our senses and thoughts that have long been normalized into neoliberal mode of life that circles around augmenting the self? Under what processes and backgrounds do your collective turn to hook soil as a site of artistic intervention?
Yeah, responding really quickly, thank you so much for the question. And then I think the term insurgents is our aspiration. And then we are slowly working towards that, I think. In terms of how it can maybe offer different senses from what we are exposed in our neoliberal world is it just working with soil makes us to take time. Whether it's farming or whether it's drawing with soil or whether it's making compost with soil or fermenting rice wine, everything takes a lot of time. And while farming is a multi-year process, fermentation takes at least 2 weeks to a month to actually happen. So just taking time and being together while things start fermenting, then we have no other choice but to talk amongst ourselves. So the kind of relationships that we cultivate with the material transformation might offer one way to counter the neoliberal world. Another is Working with soil also activates a lot of different senses that we don't normally use, or I don't normally use, having a lot of screen time. It makes us smell, it makes us kind of look at our fingernails because a lot of it gets dirty. So maybe these small moments might serve as maybe gateway for insurgents, but we are aware that that's kind of an aspirational thought. So we're working towards it, as you might have seen in our
program. Thank you. Thank you. So this is actually the first question typed into Q&A from Youngju Liu. And it's an important question. And so it might be more applicable to Eungi and perhaps Eunsan. So it's about forms of resistance, so tactics and strategies. It appears that the city-led gentrification may be even more difficult to combat for Paedari than the expressway proposal. Would you agree, Eungi? And if so, does the movement have to adopt a new set of tactics and strategies of resistance? What might they be? So you ended on a note of a larger struggle. what could be your new strategies?
Actually, it's not easy, as I mentioned in my presentation. I wanted to make Paedari a model and expand it, start from there and expand it. Instead, as I mentioned, we're becoming an isolation among huge high-rise apartment buildings. And so the question, you know, one doubts what we're as to what direction we should take from this from here on, given the situation. So as you mentioned, the expressway issue, from the, you know, the neighbors came together, and they really came together to fight hard because they were going to be the victims. And the result was, there was an agreement, and the agreement was that the city decided to build it underground rather than above ground. However, there is a demand from the neighbors to use the vacant land, to develop that land, which is not what I would prefer, but the neighbors want to use that vacant land, empty land, and do something with it. And so there was an agreement to build a community center there. And so there's that set of issues, but the Donggu, the local administration, is pursuing a tourist program. It's a constant thing. And of course, there are some people who benefit from this kind of policy, you know, shop owners, for example. I am against it, but so there are different interests within the community, within Paedari community, what I would like and what some of the other neighbors would like. So it was difficult to find a common ground there. So it's a complex situation we have. And question is, what do I do? How do we continue pursue the vision that we had, the Echo Museum, for example? I don't think there's any answer or any other way except to change the perspective of the people, the consciousness raising, you might say, and to continue point out the problems of the capital-driven development program, where a whole neighborhood is completely erased, and to make sure that people agree with you, or to try to persuade them to agree with you. I think that's all that you can really do. That's all.
Thank you. So I guess, Eunsan, you can also slightly address this question of forms of resistance. So when do you choose to design a performative interventionist activities on the sites
I've actually visited the tent that you built in near Okbaraji. I forget which year. It was temporary, yet it was a structure where anyone can visit. So how do your strategies differ depending on the struggles? In fact, yesterday we talked a little bit about the turn to majoritarian protest tactics, where scale really matters. It matters whether the protesters were larger in number than, you know, a million, right? So how do artists use different tactics in the age of mass protests and in both sides of the aisle?
I really hate to say this, but we are in the middle of war. Maybe Eun-gi agrees that every day is a battle, and the circumstances changes all the time. You know, we cannot predict, so we don't plan because it's unnecessary. And then if we plan, something changes later. So, we do many things at the same time together. So, firstly, for redevelopment project, everything demolishes really fast. So, firstly, archiving is really important. Firstly, archiving, and the research about the place and the historical and ecological whatever, and then we need to write a paper about it. So, academic paper about this value of the place. And we have to make issue. So we need to use media, like newspaper or internet media. And now we have to fight with the government and city government and the Cuba government, the three layers. So we have to fight against the three layers differently. So when we approach to Cuba and city level and the main government, the grammar is different. So we have to choose right grammar all the time. And it's very complicated, but we have to do it. And then when we need more forces from the audiences and people, we open artistic performances or like festivals to invite people, like, and like for raising funds and things like that. So we do everything we can do, really. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Well, this concludes this panel, but I just wanted to thank you all for your inspirational work on the site, and whether it's in art galleries or in the protest grounds. Thank you so much. I will support you in ways that I can.
Thank you for inviting. Bye.
Thank you.